people of God, drawn by His Spirit, longing for His word, to praise the holy name of the Lord, share His glorious news of grace, to pray for our needs and the pain of the world, to rejoice in His love and descend in His peace. We are heirs of the Father. Renewed in the Spirit, come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord. He will teach us His ways so that we may walk in His paths. Before they call, I will answer. While they are still speaking, I will hear. As we gather together this morning, we ask God to touch our hearts once again, that we may be cleansed and forgiven. Therefore, if we say we have not sinned, we deceive ourselves, the truth is not in us. We confess in repentance and trust our God is faithful. Therefore, let us be seated and kneel as we confess our sins to God together. Eternal Father, God who art with us, before your power all things tremble, but through your Son we approach you. We have done wrong and neglected to do right. Our sins weigh heavily upon our hearts. Lord, have mercy. Count them not against us. Grant us the joy of forgiveness. Enlighten our hearts to the glory of Christ, who died and rose again for us. Amen. Almighty God, may you have mercy on us all. Forgive all our sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. May strengthen us in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep us in eternal life. Amen. Blessed are those who live in your house. Praise the Lord. We all stand. Glory to the Father, in whom all things began, became the Son of God. Glory to the Spirit, who inspires and renews. The Lord our God. Jubilant song.
I will enter His gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter His courts with praise. I will sing His name as the Lord our King. I will rejoice for He has made me glad.
Verse 65 to 88.
Psalm 119 from verse 65 to 88. Do good to your servant according to your word, Lord. Teach me knowledge and good judgment, for I trust your commands. Before I was afflicted, I went astray, but now I obey your word. You are good, and what you do is good. Teach me your decrees. Though the arrogant have sneered me with lies, I keep your precepts with all my heart. Their hearts are callous and unfeeling, but I delight in your law. It was good for me to be afflicted, so that I might learn your decrees. The law from your mouth is more precious to me than thousands of pieces of silver and gold. Your hands made me and formed me. Give me understanding to learn your commands. May those who fear you rejoice when they see me, for I have put my hope in your word. I know, Lord, that your laws are righteous, and that in faithfulness you have afflicted me. May your unfailing love be my comfort, according to your promise to your servant. Let your compassion come to me, that I may live, for your law is my delight. May the arrogant be put to shame for wronging me without cause, but I will meditate on your presence. May those who fear you turn to me. Those who understand your statutes, may I wholeheartedly follow your decrees, that I may not be put to shame. My soul faints with longing for your salvation, but I have put my hope in your word. My eyes fail, looking for your promise. I say, when will you comfort me? Though I'm like a wineskin in the smoke, I do not forget your decrees. How long must your servant wait? When will you punish my prosecutors? The arrogant dig pits to trap me, contrary to your law. All your commands are trustworthy. Help me, for I am being persecuted without cause. They almost wiped me from the earth, but I have not forsaken your decrees. In your unfailing love, preserve my life, that I may obey the statutes of your mouth. Glory to the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be. Amen. We may sit. Those who are out could come in quickly, as we prepare to take on the first reading. Praise the Lord. The reading is taken from Isaiah chapter 44, beginning from verse 24, all the way to chapter 45, verse 9. Isaiah chapter 44, from verse 24 through to 45, verse 9. This is what the Lord says, your Redeemer who formed you in the womb. I am the Lord, the maker of all things, who strengthens and stretches out the heavens, who spreads out the earth by myself, who foils the signs of false prophets and makes fools of diviners, who overthrows the learning of the wise and turns it into nothing. Who carries out the words of his servant and fulfills the predictions of his messengers? Who says of Jerusalem, it shall be inhabited, of the towns of Judah, they shall be rebuilt, and of their ruins, I will restore them? Who says of the watery deep, be dry, and I will dry up your streams? Who says of Cyrus, he is my shepherd, and will accomplish all that I please? He will say of Jerusalem, let it be rebuilt, and of the temple, let its foundation be laid. chapter 45. This is what the Lord says to his anointed, to Cyrus, whose right hand I take hold of, to subdue nations before him, and to strip kings of their armor, to open doors before him, so that the gates will not be shut. I will go before you, and will level the mountains. I will break down gates of bronze, and cut through bars of iron. I will give you hidden treasures, riches stored in secret places, so that you may know that I am the Lord, the God of Israel, who summons you by name. For the sake of Jacob my servant, of Israel my chosen, I summon you by name and bestow on you a title of honor. Though you do not acknowledge me, I am the Lord and there is no other. Apart from me, there is no God. I will strengthen you, though you have not acknowledged me, so that from the rising of the sun to the place of its setting, people may know that there is no one besides me. I am the Lord and there is no other. I form the light and create darkness. I bring prosperity and create disaster. I, the Lord, do all these things. Your heavens above, rain down my righteousness. Let the clouds shower it down. Let the earth open wide. Let the salvation spring up. Let righteousness flourish with it. I, the Lord, have created it. Woe to those who quarrel with their maker, those who are nothing but potsherds among the potsherds of the ground. Does the clay say to the potter, what are you making? Does your work say, the potter has no hand? And this is the word of the Lord.
Thank you. Praise the Lord. Amen. Shall we stand? Page 20 of our Bibles, and we continue the service. We stand together with Christians throughout the centuries and throughout the world today to affirm our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of sins, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Please be seated or kneel. Your kingdom come, Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Show us your mercy, O Lord. O Lord, guide our president. May your ministers serve you faithfully.
And your love will be
trusted. In the valley of the shadow of death,
protect us with your long and love.
Like trees planted by the waterside,
grant us the fruit of your seed.
Send us out as the salt of the earth,
and as the light of the
world. And may the earth be filled with your glory. That connect today is the 14th Sunday of the Trinity or the 15th Sunday of Pentecost. Can pray together. Father, you are the Alpha and the Omega, supreme over all that you created. We acknowledge your presence in all the difficult situations we encounter from time to time. Help us, we pray, that in all our achievements, we would love the humility of Jesus, who gave up heavenly privileges for our sake. And that in all our difficulties, we recognize your Lordship in Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Prayer for peace, the second alternative we can also pray together. O God, creator of peace and lover of unity, through knowing you, we have eternal life. And in serving you, we find perfect freedom. Defend us in all attacks of our enemies, so that trusting only in your defense, you may be free from all things through the power of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Prayer for grace, the second alternative too, pray together. Lord, our Heavenly Father, almighty and ever-living God, who has brought us safely to the beginning of this day, protect us today with your mighty power, so that we do not fall into any sin or meet any danger, but all our needs may be directed to you, that we may do every day what is good in your sight, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Christine, there's one prayer for Korah as we continue.
We give you
nation into the hands of God. Pray for our leaders. Pray for yourself. Pray for your family. Pray for the church. Pray for the church leadership. And commit all that God is bringing to your heart before His throne of mercy this morning. Because He is able to hear us and He is able to offer us help in our time of need. It is an opportunity to speak to our Heavenly Father. Yes, do so. Shall we join the prayer of St. Chrysostom together? Almighty God, by your grace we have come together this time. Bring our united prayers to you. We are promised by your Son, Jesus Christ, that we are two or three are gathered in His name. We will be in the midst of them. Fulfill now, O Lord, our desires and petitions, that may be best for us, granting us in this world knowledge of your truth, and in the world to come, life everlasting, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
We once again welcome each one of us. And if you are coming for the first time, you can just wave wherever you are. You're coming for the first time. Hallelujah. You are coming for the second. Karibuni sana. Kila mmoja wetu kwa nafasi ambayo Mungu ametupatia tunapojitayarisha kusikia neno la Mungu katika kundi la sifa la praise team. As we worship God, our preacher is Jacob.
Hallelujah, praise God. Praise the name of Jesus. Are we happy in the house of the Lord today? Praise God. Amen. Let me see. Hallelujah. Let's praise the Lord together. Hallelujah. Because we are alive. It's a beautiful day. And we have all the reasons to thank God. Amen. 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 Let's praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Somebody give a praise to Jesus.
Yes, it is Jesus. opportunity that we are here to listen to you. May you teach us, O Lord, in accordance to your will. For this we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord again. My name is Jacob Atula, and we will take a few minutes, as usual, to just reflect on the Word of God as it came in the reading from the book of Isaiah, chapter 44, from verse 24, all the way to chapter 45, verse 9. Isaiah chapter 44, I will not read it again, but I will pick a few areas just to consider for this morning. Brethren, Isaiah prophesies that Israel has two needs to be delivered from: national slavery as they are carried away to Babylonian captivity, and spiritual sinfulness. Throughout this text, God is announcing how he is going to save Israel from captivity. In the chapters that follow, and it is usually good practice that once we have read a text, you take time to go through it again and see if what the servant of the Lord spoke was true. When you do that, it is good practice again to just go further, read further, and see if there is any connection to what message was brought before you. So if you read ahead in the chapters that follow, God describes in detail how he is going to save the whole world from its sins. By predicting exactly how Israel will be delivered from the Babylonians, God is showing that all the earth can trust in his promises. And so even today, we should be encouraged as we rely on the promises of God and as we learn two things concerning his faithfulness and trustworthiness of his word. Like I said, we will learn two things. The first thing, for the first lesson, is that the word of God is so strong. The word of God is very strong. God begins by calling on the people to believe in his word, and he declares that he is the Lord. He validates his divinity, his wisdom, his might, and we can see clearly that he is the maker of all things. If you read that text, you see how God describes himself, that there is nothing that can stand on his way. He is God who can turn everything upside down. And so even your situation, God is able to turn it upside down. If it be your problems, God can turn them upside down. And there is nothing that can stop God from doing anything about your situation. Not even the ideas of the most knowledgeable can stand on his way. And if we read that text, we find he's describing the ideas of the most knowledgeable, the most learned. He's calling it sheer foolishness. It is because to God, where your knowledge stops is where his starts. Meaning he is far above what you can ever imagine or think. He confirms the words of his servants and fulfills the counsel of his messengers. And so when the faithful servant of God makes certain declarations, those words happen by the power of God himself. The first declaration is in verse 26. And this is important to me. That declaration that is in chapter 44, verse 26, is interesting for sure to me. That Jerusalem will be inhabited and cities of Judah will be rebuilt. The nation of Judah and the capital city of Jerusalem will have been laid to waste and ruined by the Babylonians. But it is not over for the nation. God says that Jerusalem will be inhabited and cities will be rebuilt. And for sure, it came to pass. When I bring this before you, I remember us as a country. And I remember so far that we have come from. We remember the many problems that we have gone through as a country. And it is more painful that even currently, there are some leaders, some politicians, who go around yapping and speaking hatred in a manner as if they wish that we go back to years like 2007. But I want to take this opportunity to take those people to the Bible and to encourage us as Christians as we read Deuteronomy chapter 11 verse 12. That even as you listen to politicians speak, as you listen to people talk things that could take us back there, remember the Lord is speaking in Deuteronomy chapter 11, 12. The Bible says, it is a land that the Lord your God cares for, and the eyes of the Lord your God are continuously on it from the beginning to the end of the year. Praise the Lord. And so it does not matter. Kenya will remain because it's a land that the Lord cares for. If you are sitting very far from a politician, you would better tell them that this is not for theirs. It is not for what they want. It is for what the Lord himself designs and wants for the country of Kenya. When I go through this message, I reflect on myriad challenges facing us as families today. Abject poverty and unemployment is biting. Many are unable to afford even a single meal a day. Disease is our frequent experience, with some sicknesses robbing us of our loved ones. And constantly, we are in pain as we see our loved ones going down because disease has overtaken their lives. Even this week, I remember we buried one of our loved ones, and probably even those that went unsaved. We are related to people who suffered loss from various places to various places, and it is so painful that we are struggling with this all along. Maybe I'm speaking and you are there, and personally you are suffering. You have a sickness that has been bothered you for a long time, and you have placed it before doctors, and yet you are yet to see go through. I want to beseech you today that we will read and understand and believe the word of God and see if the Lord will not do anything about it. Family life challenges are on the rise. Couples turn against each other. Peace, love, and unity in the house is so diminishing, and even Christians are not spared. Even Christians are not spared. Even Christians are not spared. I'm saying this to mean even myself, I'm not spared. If you took a camera in my house, you might find we have issues with my wife, Ryan. Just like you may have yours. No one is immune to family life issues. And this is normal. By the way, we have called it normal. Because there have become so many until we see that it is the normal way of life. But that is not what God intends for us. That is not what God intends for the family unit. The list is endless, and I will not all call it. I would like you to reflect on your own case and ask yourself, what aspect of your life should God reveal today? As we read and we learn from what happened to Jerusalem and Israel, that the Lord finally made it come to pass, that the issues were lifted and Jerusalem came to be rebuilt and all got well again. What about your issue? What is it that you think God cannot turn around? If he did it, he can do it today. He can do it tomorrow because he remains a good God. And I take us to Jeremiah 33 verse 6 to 7. Jeremiah 33 verse 6 to 7. The Lord is making a promise upon your situation today. And as I read this, place it upon your situation. Be it sickness, be it joblessness, be it poverty, be it issues in your marriage, be it issues between yourself and your neighbors. Speak and allow the Lord to speak this promise upon it this morning. The Lord says, nevertheless, He will bring health and healing to it. Jeremiah 33 verse 6. Nevertheless, He will bring health and healing to it. He will heal you and let you enjoy peace and security. And more interestingly, that He will bring you back from captivity of that situation, and He will rebuild you as you were before. Praise the Lord. You know, that is strong. That to me is very strong. That when the word of the Lord starts with nevertheless, God is realizing that your situation may have gone to a very high extent. Your thing may have been too far. If it is pain, it may have gone too far. If it is financial inability, it may have gone too far. If it is your life, it may have gone down too far. But the Lord is saying, nevertheless, meaning even if so, He will bring health and He will bring healing to it. Meaning your situation will change and it will be back to normal again. And the Lord puts it clearly that He will rebuild and it will be as good as it was before. If you are sick, it will be rebuilt, that body of yours, and it will be as healthy as it was before. Praise the Lord. So whatever it is, I beg to beseech and to request that you lay it to God Himself, that if He did it for Israel, if He did it for Judah and Jerusalem, He can do your case also. Lesson number 2. Never shall we contend with God in His plans. Never shall we contend with God in His plans. As God's people, we may not like how He operates in the world. Yes. We may think that God should do things a little differently. Even the coronavirus disease, we may think that God should have stopped it long time ago. But yet we still see cases. And we may be wondering, we have prayed upon God. We have beseeched. What is God doing? Why is He not behaving? It gets us to a point where now we are contending with God and we are asking Him to do things our way. What is surprising is, even when God starts to do what you ask for, you still find people complaining. Right now, corona cases are going down, isn't it? Yeah. But it is even a source of complaint. There are people who are complaining. Why is it going down? Yet, even travel, airspace was opened. Curfews were lifted or adjusted. So now people have interactions even more. So knowledgeable people now say, we expect the cases to be higher. Because if they were in 600 and above, when there were no international travel, and you could not go to a country and come to Nairobi. Now that all that is happening, how comes the cases are going down? Somebody says that politicians must be playing a game here. They must have just had enough of it. They must have looted enough. So now they want to close this case. So cases must come down. Praise the Lord. What kind of nonsense? I'm using that term because I've read it here. If you read the psalm that we read today, you'll have that word, God speaking it Himself. What do you want God to do? When the cases were rising, we were on our knees praying, God, please bring this down. When now cases are going down, we are asking how comes. The lesson for today is teaching us to let God do His thing as God. Praise the Lord. One can imagine how Israel did not like the idea of their deliverance coming at the hands of the Persian governor and conqueror. They may not have wanted to go into Babylon and into captivity and remain there for 70 years. They may not have liked. But in the same way, people today complain about how God rules this world and how he operates in his lives. Worse, we even resist the Lord in the lives because of various life circumstances. When you have a matter, you see God's hand in it. You complain. Listen to what God is saying about this in verse 9 of chapter 45. If you were with us when we were doing that reading, where we ended, verse 9, the Bible puts it this way. Does the clay speak back to the potter? Can the clay tell the potter that the potter does not know what he's doing? Can it tell the maker it does not like the way it's making it? Yes. And the point is this. The potter has every right to form the clay in any manner fit to him. And as Christians, we must come to a critical truth. To love God means we must let him be God. We cannot tell God the way it is or the way it is supposed to be. When we insist that God does things our way, then we are not allowing God to be our God. It is an obvious reality, yet a concept that is so easily neglected. Everything God does is right. Praise the Lord. And Psalm 119, verse 68, the psalm that was read to us, the Bible says, he is good, and everything he does is good. He is our God, and therefore we must yield to him. He does not do things according to our wisdom. He acts in his own wisdom, which defies all human understanding. So Christians, may we faithfully put our faith in our God and believe that the way he is doing it is the best way for us. If tomorrow the cases would go up, as Christians, that is what God wants. If the cases would continue to go down, we would appreciate that the Lord is answering our prayer. And we let him move those cases to the point of zero. And then life goes back to normal again. It cannot be now because we want it now. It cannot be tomorrow because we want it tomorrow. It shall be at the time God wants it to be zero. Praise the Lord. In conclusion, God has proven to keep his word through the text that we have read. When God says it is, it happens because he rules over everything. The history of Babylon and the release of Israel is a basis for us to trust in the word of the Lord. Now God has promised that he will wipe out our sins and remember them no more if we seek his face and allow him to be our God. That is my request for us this morning. That we may allow God to be a God to us. That we may see the face of the Lord. That we may repent of our sins. And he says, if the people who are called by my name would humble themselves and seek my face and turn away from their wickedness, then he will listen and he will hear. And he will answer our prayers. Praise the Lord. And so as the psalmist prayed in Psalm 119, from verse 65 to 88, which was read to us, may the Lord do good to us according to his word. May his unfailing love be our comfort in line with his promise. And may his grace preserve our lives, that we may be there to obey his commands. In the name of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you so much, Brother Jacob. God is good. God is loving. And God is gracious. We thank God for His word. As we continue to worship God in conclusion for this first service, I just remind us from the scripture, Philippians chapter 4, verse 11. Paul is saying, "Note that I speak in regard to need, for I have learned in whatever state I am to be content." In other words, giving teaches us contentment. Praise the Lord. Giving teaches us to be contented because it is God we rely on to provide for our needs. Shall we stand and as we give our offerings and tithes, we can use either the online avenues, or if you have to bring your offering here in front, you are also free to do so. But whichever way, we just learn to take good care of ourselves. Shall we see the online mode is on the screen? We shall sing a song as we do that. More about Jesus would I know. More of His grace to others should. I know there are those who have those songs in their phones and
more about Jesus would I know, more of His grace to all the shore, more of His saving goodness, more of His love who died for me, more about Jesus.
The opportunity to work with our hands. that in our work, Lord, you bless us financially. Because you bless us, Lord, you also require us to offer our services to you and to worship you through our giving. And so we thank you for accepting us, that we are made worthy to stand before you as we give our offerings and our tithes. May it please you, O Lord, to accept these gifts. May it please you to sanctify these gifts. And may it please you that these gifts may be dedicated for use in extending your kingdom as you bless each one of us through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Continue praying. Mighty God, we pray that the words which we have heard today that has come to us clearly shall transform our lives and shall cause us to be able to bring forth fruit for the glory of your holy name. Even as we continue to reflect on your goodness, we pray that, Lord, your blessing may abound in our lives and the lives of our loved ones. And now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus, throughout all generations, forever and ever, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you and your loved ones now and always. Amen. Thank you so much for your time. Just one announcement. This is a thanksgiving from one of us. That is Gidai's family. They are thanking all of us for standing with them after the demise of their beloved mom. And they are saying that God may continue to bless each one of us for the love that we have shown Gidai's family. God bless you. Our recession of him is, he leadeth me, O blessed thought. He leadeth me, O blessed thought, is on the screen.
He leadeth me, O blessed thought. He leadeth me.
Where I be?
Thank you.